Good morning, everyone. Today I'm going to teach you a poem, Fire and Ice. Fire and Ice is written by Robert Frost. Now, something about the poet. Robert Frost is one of the famous American poets and one of the celebrated poets of 1920s. And if I talk about this poem, Fire and Ice, it got published during that period only. It got published in 1923. Now, let's look at the poem. It's a short lyric, just comprising of two stanzas, that's nine lines. No doubt, the language is very simple. The lyric is short, but compact. The subject taken is sublime. The poet has taken an universal issue, that is, the end of the existing world. The poet believes that this existing world will come to an end one day or the other. Sooner or later. Now he is not clear when will the world come to an end, and he draws the conclusion on the beliefs of the people, which is quite divided. But poet is very much certain that this world will come to an end, because everything that has a beginning or origin comes to an end one day or the other. Now I'm going to paraphrase the poem for you. First stanza. Some say the world will end in fire. Some say in ice. From what I've tasted of desire, I hold with those who favor fire. Hold here means be in favor, be in favor of. Now, this poem is symbolic, where fire and ice have a symbolic meaning. Fire here signifies unchecked passions and uncontrolled desires. And I stands for cold reasoning, that is hatred. Some people say that the world will end in fire, that fire will be the cause of the end of this world. That means the desires, uncontrolled desires, will end in destruction. Whereas the other people say that the world will end because of hatred. Now in line 3, the poet has given his own opinion. He says, I have tasted of desire, that I have enough experience of desire, of endless desires, and I hold with those who favor fire. He says, I am with those people who think that the world will end because of fire. Let's go to the second stanza now. But if it had to perish twice, I think I know enough of hate to say that for destruction, ice is also great and would suffice. Now, the word meanings here in this stanza, there are two words. One is perish, that means to die or to come to an end. And the suffice in the last line means sufficient or enough. The poet says that if it stands for word, had to come to an end twice, two times. Then he says, I have enough experience of hatred also, ice also, that is hatred. And he says, even ice has the potential, the capability to end this word. And that would also be the specific end. So this is the gist of the poem. Now let's talk about the rhyming scheme of the poem. For rhyming scheme, we see the last word of each line. And if the words have the same sound, then they come under one particular alphabet. Let's see the first four lines. Line one is ending with fire. Line three with desire. And line four with fire again. All three are same sounds, so we will categorize them as A. Whereas line two is ending with ice, that is a totally different sound. So this will be categorized as B. So the rhyme scheme for stanza one is A, B, A, A. Now, second stanza. Second stanza, line one has the last word twice, which is same sound of ice, in line 2. Then line 3 also has ice and line 5 has suffice. So twice, ice, suffice, same sound. They will be categorized as B. Whereas line 2 and 4, which are ending with the word hate and great respectively, are totally a different sound. They are neither like fire nor like ice. So they will be categorized as C. And the rhyming scheme for stanza 2 would be B, C, B, C, B. So stanza 1 rhyming scheme is A, B, A, A. And for B, second stanza, we have B, C, B, C, B. Now, I have a tabular thing for you, tabular question. Here it is, emotions that can be categorized as fire and ice. There are certain emotions which can be categorized as fire and ice. I would again specify, fire stands for uncontrolled passions and unchecked desires, and ice stands for cold reasoning. That means when a human being is devoid of feelings like love, warmth, sympathy, and this gives birth to contempt and hatred, which can again be the cause of destruction of this world. So under fire, we have greed, fury. Fury is anger. Lust. Lust is also excessive greed, and avarice also is greed. So these are like, you know, desires. When we wish to have one thing after the other. Now the second column, ice, has the words coldness, indifference. When we have indifferent attitude to the other person, that is, we have hatred, insensitivity, unemotional, and rigidity. Rigidity is when you stick to your point and you don't want to listen to others. Again, this is a sign, something negative, which breeds contempt and hatred. Next, we will talk about the poetic devices. Now, in this particular poem, the very first poetic device is alliteration. Alliteration is the repetition of consonant sounds in the same line, such as the sound of F in I hold with those who favor fire. See the words favor, fire. Both are starting with the same sound, consonant sound, that is for F. I hold with those who favor fire. So this kind of poetic device where there's a repetition of consonant sound in a line, that is called alliteration. Next we have symbolism. Symbolism is a use of symbols to signify ideas and qualities by giving them symbolic meanings different from their literal meanings. Like in this poem, fire and ice are not having their literal meanings. Fire is the symbol of desires and ice symbolizes hatred. Now this is symbolism. Like they have not been used for their literal meanings, that is fire and ice, but they have their symbolic meaning. Fire is the symbol of desire and ice symbolizes hatred. Next we have anaphora. It refers to the repetition of a word or expression in the first part of some verses. Let me show you how. Now look at line 1 and 2. Here we have, some say the word will end in fire, some say in ice. Like both the lines are beginning with the same words. Some say. So let us talk about the definition once again. It refers to the repetition of a word or expression in the first part of some verses. Like line 1 of the poem and line 2 of the poem are starting with the same words. Some say. Then we have personification. Personification is to give human qualities to inanimate objects. Non-living objects. In this poem, fire and ice are capable of destruction. Therefore, the poet personifies fire and ice by giving them a mind which is capable of destroying almost everything, like fire and ice, even though they are non-living things. But they have been given human qualities and they have been animated. They have become the cause of destruction of the world. So this is called personification. The last poetic device here we have, enjambment. It is defined as a thought or clause that does not come to an end at a line break, rather it moves over to the next line. For example, from what I have tasted of desire, I hold with those who favor fire. This particular line, from what I have tasted of desire, does not end here. The idea is same, but it's just continuing to the moving on to the next line. Like, I hold with those who favor fire. So this kind of poetic device is called enjambment. Now in this poem, the truth for Robert Frost is ambiguous. The question remains unanswered, whether the world will end in fire or in ice. But the poem has a very strong message and a warning for the readers that humanity can redeem or possibly save or delay its end by avoiding such kind of extremes, thinking and behavior like fire and ice. Thank you.